The time has come to explain a strange mental state of our master in the face of the public prosecutors. Footnote: I'm presenting this absolutely true letter which our master wrote for you. His student, Sungur. He said to me, although during these 30 to 40 years of oppression, in prison, and exile, I have been the object of the severity of the public prosecutors who are charged with duties related to public law, known as hukukullah, I have never felt angry at them or offended. I realized that I did not see in them the faults that were the cause of their apparent anger. Then, sometime later, I saw that the compassionate slaps of divine determining were dealt at the hand of the prosecutors due to my own faults. Because the slaps came from divine determining, I accepted them with all my spirit and heart, and I forgave the prosecutors' harshness, for they were only the apparent causes. Now, thanks be to God, some of the prosecutors, in performing their duties of defending the public rights, insofar as they are hukukullah, are not treating me so severely, on the contrary, in respect of true justice, and the service the Risale-i-Nur performs for belief, which is beneficial for all Muslims and even humanity, they are giving up their severity and are as though seeing the compassionate slaps of divine determining and assisting us despite their apparent torments. As a consequence of this great mystery, I have assumed a friendly attitude towards all such prosecutors, and I pray for them. The situations which appear to be severe judgments against me are advertisements of a sort for our work for belief. I now send my greetings to them and to all who understand that public law has become like hukukullah, and I pray for them. I forgive their severity and vehemence towards me. Said Nursi. A letter of Bediüzzaman Said Nursi to the newspapers. I have written this letter to the newspapers which write about the matters that concern us. If they publish it, I shall forgive all that they have attributed to us recently. It is very short due to my severe illness. Let them publish it so that my brothers who think of us are not saddened. Firstly, do not worry about what is happening these days. What is being manifested concerning us comprises great instances of good, through divine providence and mercy. I am ill and cannot endure to speak and meet with people. With the Risale-i-Nur spreading so widely both at home and abroad, and its conquests, enemies even are becoming friends. Everyone wants to speak with me, but through divine providence, I have lost my voice. I cannot speak and see people because the Risale-i-Nur leaves no need for me. When setting out in response to the invitations to me from six provinces, some friendly officials who understand the Risale-i-Nur and my way stopped us and informed us that the government requested that for now I remain and rest in Emirdağ. In any event, since I cannot endure to speak and see people, their friendly proposal was providential. My three brothers who have invited me from many provinces should not be upset. Anyway, if I had gone to some provinces and not to others, hundreds of thousands of my true devoted brothers might have felt offended. They should feel no offense. Secondly, evidence that these journeys of mine are in no way concerned with politics is that I have given up politics for the past 40 years and have been preoccupied with the Risale-i-Nur alone, which is a Quranic commentary that is altogether appropriate for the times. The Risale-i-Nur has smashed absolute disbelief and has thus acted as a barrier before anarchy and destructive currents. Moreover, in accordance with the meaning of the verse, no bearer of burdens can bear the burden of another, which is a fundamental law of the Quran, it has taught to the Risale-i-Nur. The Risale-i-Nur has been most beneficial for this country and nation and public order, since to disturb order and security means causing harm to 90 innocents on account of 5 criminals. In consequence, I forgive the police who spy on me or cause me trouble. They are the Mujahid preservers of the peace, and I happily accept them as brothers. In fact, just as I complied with their turning me back from Ankara, so I offer thanks to God, since they were a cause of divine grace. I turned back from Ankara with complete peace of mind. Thirdly, because the Risale-i-Nur is spreading everywhere and being read and sought eagerly, they wanted to invite me and see me and speak with me. I would have had to visit 20 provinces, but I only went to Ankara, Istanbul, and Konya, where the Risale-i-Nur is being printed. I say this to the friends who sent me back to Emirdağ. Their treatment turned out to be an instance of divine grace and mercy for me. I am not annoyed. Only, I have a house I have rented for 2 years and some belongings in Isparta province, where I lived for 20 years. The air there is also somewhat beneficial to my illness. With the government's permission, I want to stay for a month in Emirdağ and a month in the house I have rented in Isparta. Bediüzzaman Said Nursi. The last instruction our master Bediüzzaman gave the Nur students generally before his death. My dear brothers, our duty is to act positively, it is not to act negatively. It is solely to serve the cause of belief in accordance with the divine pleasure and not interfere with God's concerns. We are charged with responding with patience and thanks to every difficulty we may meet in the positive service to belief, a consequence of which is the preservation of public order and security. Taking myself as an example, I say, formerly, I never bowed before tyranny or humiliating treatment. Numerous events established that I could never endure to be treated in that way. For example, not rising to my feet before the commander-in-chief in Russia, and my giving no importance to the Pasha's questions in the military court even when under threat of execution, as well as my attitude to four commanders, all show that I never bowed before domination. But these last 30 years, for the sake of acting positively and not acting negatively and not interfering in God's concerns, I have responded with patience and resignation to all the treatment I have received. I have met it with patience and resignation like judges, upon whom be peace, and those who suffered the extreme difficulties of the battles of Badr and Uhud. Yes, for example, I did not even curse a public prosecutor whose 81 errors I had proved in court, as a result of whose false accusations the decision was taken against us. For the essential matter at this time is the jihad of the world, or moral jihad, jihad manevi. It is to form a barrier against the moral and spiritual destruction, and to assist internal order and security with all our strength. Yes, there is a power in our way, but this force is for preserving public order. According to the principle of no bearer of burdens can bear the burden of another, the brother, family, or children of a criminal cannot be held responsible for him. It is because of this that throughout my life, we have endeavored with all our strength to maintain public order. This force may not be employed internally, but only against external aggression. Our duty in accordance with the above verse is to assist the maintenance of internal order and security with all our strength. It is for this reason that within the world of Islam internal destructive conflicts damaging public order have been negligible and arose from differences in interpretation of the law. The most important condition of the jihad of the world is not interfering in God's concerns, that is, to say, our duty is to serve, its results are Almighty God's concern. We are charged with carrying out our duty and are obliged to do so. Similarly to Celaleddin Harzemşah, I have learned from the Quran to say, my duty is to serve religious belief. It is Almighty God's concern whether or not He makes it successful, and to act with sincerity. External aggression may be met with force, for the enemy's positions and dependents are like woody. But this is not the case internally. Internal action should be in accordance with the true meaning of sincerity and means acting in positive, non-physical fashion against the moral and spiritual destruction. External and internal jihad are completely different. Almighty God has now given me millions of true students. Internally, we shall act positively only to maintain public order and secrecy. The difference at this time between internal and external jihad is truly great. There is another question which is also of supreme importance. According to the injunctions of the Quran, at this time, due to the demands of modern law, civilization essential needs have risen from 4 to 20. As a result of addiction, custom, and habit, inessential needs have become like essential needs. Although one believes in the hereafter, he says, it's necessary, and because of this gives preference to this world over the hereafter for worldly benefits and because of the struggle for livelihood. 40 years ago, in order to accustom me to this world a little, a commander-in-chief sent some high-ranking officers and even some hojas to me. They told me, as dictated by the rule, necessity makes permissible what is prohibited. We are now compelled to adopt some of the Europe's principles and imitate some of the requirements of civilization. I told them, you are grievously deceived. If necessity arises from unlawful deeds, it certainly is not right. It does not make licit what is illicit. If it does not arise from a wrong, that is, if it has not arisen from an unlawful action, it is not harmful. For example, if a man deliberately gets drunk in unlawful fashion, and when drunk commits a crime, the judgment will be against him, he will not be considered excused and will pay the penalty for the necessity resulted from a voluntary wrong action. But if an insane youth shoots someone when in a state of insanity, he is excused, he will receive no penalty because it was not voluntary. I asked the commander and the man of religion, what essentials are there outside having bread to eat and maintaining a livelihood? Voluntary actions arising from illicit desires and unlawful dealings cannot make what is unlawful lawful. Since things like the cinema, theater, and dancing are not essential and addiction to them results from a voluntary wrong action, if a person becomes addicted to them, it cannot be a reason for making the illicit licit. Laws whose source is human have also taken this point into consideration, for they differentiate between definite necessity outside the will and matters arising from voluntary unlawful acts. The one laws differentiate in firmer and more fundamental fashion between these basic matters. Nevertheless, do not attack those hojas who support innovations, supposing that they are made essential by the times. Do not strike at those unfortunates who unknowingly act on the supposition of there being necessity. For this reason, we do not employ our force internally. We do not interfere with the unfortunates who oppose us, saying, such and such has become essential, even if they are hojas. I previously held out on my own against so many opponents, not varying even a jot, and was successful in serving belief. Although there are no millions of Risale-i Nur students, I still endure all their insults and persecution to react positively. We do not consider the world. If we do consider it, we try to assist those involved in it. We assist in positive fashion the preservation of public order and security. Because of facts like this, we have to tolerate it, even if they persecute us. The Risale-i Nur's spreading everywhere has given rise to the firm conviction that the Democrats support religion. To hamper a single treatise now is directly contrary to the benefits of the country and nation. A small example of the rule, necessity arising from a voluntary unlawful action does not make what is unlawful lawful. There was a confidential treatise, the publication of which I prevented. I said that it could be published after my death. Later, the court seized it and studied it, then they acquitted it. The Court of Appeal upheld the acquittal. And, in order to preserve public order internally, and so that no harm should come to the 99 innocents out of 100 people, I gave permission to the publishers, saying, Said may publish it on consulting with others. Third matter. Absolute disbelief is now trying to spread such a hell that no disbeliever in the universe should approach it. An inner meaning of the Quran being a mercy to all the worlds is this, that just as it is mercy for Muslims, so, by offering the possibility of belief in the hereafter and belief in God, it is a subtle sign of its being a mercy to all unbelievers and all the world and mankind. For it saves them to an extent from that immaterial hell in this world too. But now, the misguided sort of science and philosophy, that is, the sort which is not reconciled with the Quran and has strayed from the path and opposes the Quran, absolute disbelief, has begun to be spread in the form of communism. Since it has begun to be inculcated and spread by means of dissemblers and atheists and some extremist irreligious politicians, covertly as communism in such a way that will result in anarchy, it is not possible to live now without religion. The saying, a nation cannot continue to exist without religion, alludes to this point. Absolute disbelief is not viable, it cannot be lived. That is why the all-wise Quran has taught the Risale-i Nur students this age in miraculous fashion that they should form a barrier against absolute unbelief and anarchy. And so they have. Yes, what has protected us against this current, which has overrun half Europe and the Balkans, is this lesson of the wise Quran. It has formed a barrier against its assault, and in this way, found a solution for the danger. This means that it is not possible for a Muslim to embrace another religion and become a Christian or a Jew or especially a communist. For if a Christian becomes a Muslim, he loves Jesus, upon whom be peace, even more. And if a Jew becomes a Muslim, he loves Moses, upon whom be peace, even more. But if a Muslim breaks away from the chain of Muhammad, upon whom be blessings and peace, and gives up his religion, he will not embrace any other religion, he becomes an anarchist, and nothing remains in his spirit that may lead to perfection and attainment. His conscience is corrupted, and he becomes poison in the life of society. It is because of this that, thanks be to God, a Quranic miracle, a lesson of the Quran called the Risale-i Nur, has begun to spread among the heroic Arab and Turkish peoples. Alluded to by the all-wise Quran, and in the Arabic and Turkish languages, it will save this age. 16 years ago, it has saved the belief of 600,000 people, and now it has been established that the number exceeds millions. That is to say, just as the Risale-i Nur has been a means of saving mankind from anarchy to an extent, so it has been a means of uniting the Turks and Arabs, the two heroic brothers of Islam, and disseminating these fundamental laws of the Quran, as even its enemies have confirmed. Absolute disbelief is opposing the Quran at the present time. Absolute disbelief comprises a hell in this world that is greater than hell itself. For since death is not killed, and every day 30,000 human deaths testify to its continuous, thinking of their own eternal annihilation and that of all their relatives of the past and future, those who fall into absolute disbelief, or those who support it, suffer torments 10 times severer than hell. That is, owing to their absolute disbelief, they feel that hellish torment in their hearts. For a person is happy at the happiness of his relatives, and is tormented at their torments, and due to the beliefs of the deniers of God, all their happiness is destroyed and replaced by torment. Thus, at this time, there is one single way dispelling this immaterial hell from people's hearts in this world, and that is the All-Wise Quran and the Risale-i-Nur and its various parts, which is a miracle of the Quran in accordance with the understanding of the age. Now, we offer thanks to God that one party among the political parties has realized this to an extent, for it has not prevented the publication of those verbs. It has not hindered the Risale-i-Nur, which proves that the truths of belief gain a non-material heaven for believers in this world. It has permitted its publication and given up pressurizing its publishers. My brothers, my illness is very severe. Perhaps I shall die soon or be prevented from speaking altogether, as I am sometimes now. Therefore, saying that they are the lesser of two evils, my Nur brothers of the hereafter should not attack certain unfortunate, mistaken people because of their mistakes. They should always act positively. Acting negatively is not our concern. For action internally may not be negative. Since some of the politicians cause no harm to the Risale-i-Nur and are a little tolerant, look on them as the lesser of two evils. Cause them no harm and do them good, so that you may be saved from a greater evil. Also, internal jihad of the world is to work against the moral and spiritual devastation. It is not material or physical service that is needed, but non-physical and moral. For this reason, we do not interfere with the politicians, nor have the politicians any right to busy themselves with us. For example, I have forgiven a certain party despite its having inflicted thousands of sorts of difficulties on me, and even 30 years of imprisonment and persecution. And I have been instrumental in 95% of those unfortunates being saved from insult, criticism, and oppression. For according to the verse, no bearer of burdens can bear the burden of another, the fault was ascribed to only 5%. The party which opposed us has no right whatsoever now to complain about us. In one court, even attempts were made to convict us, 70 people, as a result of the delusions of spies and informers, and to convict me due to misunderstandings and carelessness, and 80 errors by attaching false meanings to certain parts of the Risale-i-Nur, as had been proved in a number of courts. But while a prisoner, one of your brothers who had been subject to the worst attacks saw the public prosecutor's 3-year-old child out of the window. He asked, and they told him, "It is the public prosecutor's daughter." For the sake of that innocent child, he did not curse the prosecutor. Indeed, since the troubles he had inflicted had resulted in advertising the Risale-i-Nur, that non-material miracle, and in furthering its dissemination, they had been transformed into mercy. My brothers, perhaps I shall soon die. This age has another sickness, sicknesses like egotism, self-centeredness, self-advertisement, the desire to pass one's life comfortably in accordance with the fantasies of modern civilization, and to be obsessed with this. The first and most important lesson the Risale-i-Nur has learned from the Quran is the necessity to give up egotism, selfishness, and self-advertisement so that the saving of belief may be served with true sincerity. Thanks be to God, numerous people have emerged who have gained that maximum sincerity. There are many who sacrifice their egotism a reputation and good name for the smallest matter of belief. For example, when the enemies of one unfortunate student of the Risale-i Nur became friends, divine mercy made him lose his voice because their conversations with him increased. Also, the looks of those who consider him admiringly strike him like the evil eye and cause him pain. Shaking hands even causes him distress as though he had received a blow. He was asked, "What is this condition of yours? You have millions of friends. Why do you not meet with them for their sake?" He replied, "Since our way is maximum sincerity, it necessitates preferring a single eternal matter of belief to rule over the whole world, even if it were to be given, let alone egotism and selfishness." For example, in the midst of the enemy's fire in the front lines in the war, he gave greater importance to a single point of a single letter of a single verse of the all-wise Quran and ordered his scribe, Habib, when under the rain of the bullets, take out the notebook and dictated that point to him on horseback. That is to say, he did not abandon a single letter or point of the Quran in the face of the enemy bullets, he preferred it to saving his own life. We asked that brother of ours where he had learned such extraordinary sincerity. He said, from two points. The first is the glory of the world, upon whom be blessings and peace, commanding in a hadith, despite the enemy's assault at one of times of the prescribed prayers during the Battle of Badr, the most wondrous battle in the history of Islam, that half of the mujahids should lay aside their arms and join the congregation so as not to be deprived of the benefits of the congregation, and that they should pray two rakats, and then the other half should do likewise. Since there is permission to do this in battle, and since the benefit of praying in congregation has been established by the prophets upon whom be blessings and peace practices, complying with that practice was given priority over the most momentous of worldly affairs. Taking one small point from such a hint of the Absolute Master, upon whom be blessings and peace, we follow it with all our strength and spirit. Secondly, in many places of his Jajalatuya, and at the end of it, Imam Ali, may God be pleased with him, the champion of Islam, asked for a protector so that heedlessness should not encroach on his sense of the Divine Presence during the five daily prayers. He beseeched the Divine Court for a protecting spirit being, solely so that an assault by his enemies should not occur to him, and the thought of his very numerous enemies attacking him should not hinder his sense of the Divine Presence during the prayers. Thus, this wretched brother of yours, whose life at this time is afflicted with self-advertisement, learned these two small points from the reason for the world's creation, upon whom be blessings and peace, and the champion of Islam. Attaching importance to the Quran's mysteries, which are so necessary at this time, he did not think of protecting his own life in battle and expounded one fine point of one letter of the Quran. Said Nursi.